So the final session again for speakers. First speaker is Shane Gu, who will be talking about temporal difference models, deep model-free RL for model-based RL.
Okay, so my name is Shane. I'm a PhD student with Rich, but this work was done during my internship at Google, so it doesn't go, I'm from collaborative from Cambridge, but hopefully it's also new material for people from the lab. So today I'll talk about this model-free RL for model-based RL, and I'll kind of explain what it means for that. So I think it's good to celebrate the kind of success of kind of model-free deep reinforcement learning. Model-free reinforcement learning is a very general framework for solving kind of sequential decision matching problem. And thankfully to EY, who kind of introduced more notations, I'll not kind of go through this again. But it's a very kind of general framework that we can try to learn various kind of tasks, and it's shown to be very successful solving very difficult tasks. And the thing about those that's very nice is that it's very general and kind of universal. And for example, kind of model-based algorithms. I'll kind of briefly kind of explain the model-based, model-free. Model-based is basically you learn the dynamics of this kind of environment, and then you basically use that model to kind of roll out, and then the optimization, which at that point basically becomes something like backpropagation to optimize for the policy. But the model-free methods basically don't basically learn this kind of dynamic information and just directly try to maximize a reward, assuming you can only kind of sample from dynamics. So there's been a lot of success, but I also say there's a lot of limitation for those kind of success. So the first is that a lot of those model-free algorithms are very highly sample intensive. So they can work to solve problems in simulation, have this kind of amazing parkour movements, but in real world, to train this kind of robot to do that, it's almost impossible. And also, unfortunately, some of the kind of, for continuous control, some of the benchmarks we kind of thought were kind of difficult, in the end, we actually can solve reasonably without the deep neural network, like linear policies or just with some kind of random features. And probably the worst part is that maybe the RL is not necessary, in that there are a bunch of recent work that show evolutionary methods or some kind of random search can also solve a lot of some of the previously thought difficult benchmark problems. So I think I'd say that there's kind of potential cause for this and for this kind of three problems. And I think it's really that the kind of classic way the model-free RL is defined lacks kind of rich learning signals that I can leverage. So I'd like to kind of start by kind of having, kind of showing kind of, I guess, four kind of way of kind of solving reinforcement learning problem. And on this kind of graph, you kind of lay out like this. Wait, you cannot see, okay. Sorry, there's some kind of boxes, but okay, never mind. So basically, like on y-axis, I have this kind of how much data each of the method take, and the other axis kind of show how general kind of complex task each of the branch of the method can solve. So first we have this kind of, model-based method. So when they solve it, because they use supervised learning to learn the model, so if they can solve the task, it's very generally very sample efficient. But there's kind of a limit to how difficult the task can solve. So for example, you can like solve until like here, like in terms of difficulty. Well, off-policy stuff, it has more general, so it can solve in here, and on-policy stuff, say, like, can solve a bit harder, and inversion stuff can solve, like, a bit more. But each time, like, as the method kind of go to right, it takes, like, say, 10 or 100 times more samples to solve kind of similar difficulty kind of problem. So the kind of ideally, the a good direction to explore is to try to reach its kind of top left. If you want to solve real problems, difficult problems, then you want to be to solve very general hard tasks, but also be very sample efficient. So a lot of kind of my prior work also focused on kind of bridging gaps between those kind of branches of reinforcement learning. And often what we can do is we can improve both the stability and sample efficiency of those methods. And today's talk is also kind of going to this kind of corner bridging gap of model-based and of policy. So to give kind of more kind of motivation, I kind of call this like a curse of cherries because they've been hunting me for the past 2 years since the Jan Lecoux introduced this slide of cake and cherry. He basically said the model-free RL is just the cherry, and then the model-based, or kind of, I guess he called unsupervised learning, is the cake, which means is that the model-free RL really can't leverage the kind of deep neural network well. So to kind of show this more concretely, here, like in something, when you consider the kind of data you collect, you have different policies, say, hopefully kind of improving over time. And then for each policy, you kind of collect a number of trajectories by rolling out that policy. So evolutionary methods, it basically doesn't use any of the previous experience, and it collapses all those kind of trajectory from kind of single policy into like just one number. And I guess you kind of find some kind of random, like a local policy on invariant as well. But basically, you just take kind of single scale out of all those kind of rich experience. And on policy method is a bit better. It ditches all the previous kind of policy experiences, but it can use kind of the rewards coming from each of the robot trajectories. And off-policy kind of model-free is better in that it can use most of the rewards for also from all the previous kind of policies. But really, like, something that's really nice is the model-based, which is by learning this kind of dynamics, you basically leverage all the information from any of the previous policy and all the kind of information in the kind of state kind of action kind of reward transitions. And this is often kind of showing the result in that the kind of more kind of learning signaling kind of feel, the general, when those methods work, the sample efficiency is very good. So in this talk, I'll mostly kind of talk about how can we say do something like kind of model-free to so that you can solve kind of harder tasks, but you can leverage as much or even more learning signals as model-based. So to summarize the problem statements of this, how can we increase the amount of learning signals in kind of model-free RL? There are a few kind of prior work for this. It's like auxiliary task, accurate prediction, often inverse kind of add some kind of prediction rewards to it. There's also this kind of inverse value function, the HER, I'll explain next. They'll connect to the work I present now. And also this question that can leverage as much or more learning signals than model-based, but still have, say, kind of as long convergence of the model-free algorithm. So I'll briefly explain the kind of high sign expense replay. It's basically just a, say, kind of off-policy, kind of Q-learning algorithm where they define this parameterized reward function. So now the reward is not just kind of state action next state. It also takes in kind of parameter, which is the goal it's trying to reach. And the reward is if it reached the goal, then you can get to receive the reward. So if you learn the Q function for this, then basically the Q function, then some kind of probability of reaching like a kind of goal, some kind of goal state from your kind of current state. So in HER, what they do is that, so often in kind of sparse problem, if you just run some policy, it doesn't reach the kind of goal you wanted to reach by basically kind of going some trajectory. And what HER does is that it takes all the future state arrived and treat those as if they are the kind of goals that this you're trying to reach from the state ST and AT. So basically, on hindsight, you're relabeling the this kind of parameters in off-policy learning. And this has shown to kind of solve some of the difficult sparse real problems, as in this. But if you kind of look closely at some of the x-axis, this method is actually very sample intensive. I guess one is really kind of focused on sparse real problems, so they're by nature that, and then even if, say, for the same state action next state, you sample many goals, each of the goal basically only gives like 0-1 kind of reward, so it's still like a very sparse kind of reward you get. And another thing is that the way they kind of relabel is also kind of limited by just taking the kind of future success or kind of positive goals they was able to achieve. So kind of starting from here, the question is, can we take this kind of ideal relabeling and then kind of improve the kind of sample efficiency like much more drastically? So this is like a very simple example, but I like it. So this is basically a task of trying to teach a half cheetah to run different velocities, sample from minus 10 to 10. And so typically when you do kind of reinforcement learning, each episode, say you sample different target velocity, and then you basically get curves like this. And this is like correspond to you increase number of updates you do the parameters given the kind of sample. And then often it kind of saturates, for example, with kind of 50 update per sample, it's basically about the same as 10 update per sample. But if you use a relabeling trick, which means when you do off-policy Q-learning, you don't just use the goal stored in the replay buffer, but use the kind of goal that you kind of regenerate from another distribution, then you basically can get kind of further improvement. So basically this says if you have some kind of like a reinforcement learning task that's kind of can be framed as like if the dynamics is the same and kind of frame as doing kind of multiple goal stuff, if you resample this kind of goal or task parameters in off-policy learning, often you can actually kind of get just kind of improvement in sample efficiency more. And this is also using both positive and negative goals. So from this, the kind of thing I'd say is that for off-policy reinforcement learning, it's kind of true, but previously basically says the it can reuse a state action reward next state from any policy, but the true benefit is you can use state action next state from any policy and basically learn a Q function against any kind of reward functions. And this now kind of starts feel more like model-based reinforcement learning in that it's not just trying to learn like a Q function for a single scalar reward, but it's trying to have infinite set of reward functions. And through those infinite set of reward functions, it's trying to learn many kind of statistics about the state action next state transitions also with kind of planning extract out of it. So is there a more kind of exact connection? And that's where I kind of discuss some of the basics in kind of model-based reinforcement learning. So this is one of the simplest way to do model-based reinforcement learning in that you first learn this kind of transition dynamics. So given state and action, what is the next state? Just using supervised learning. And then the NPC, what they do is at the test time, if you give them state ST, then you just roll out like with a sequence of actions using this model, and then you basically try to maximize the reward respect to the actions and take the first action and repeat it. So you can simply like you can write this more in kind of implicit form in that now you're not optimizing over a sequence of actions, but also optimizing a sequence of future states. But you ensure that sequence future states satisfy the constraint imposed by the dynamics. So this is exactly the same as writing this way. But by iterating this, we can kind of write connection to, say, the Q function, like this kind of parameterized Q functions. So for example, if you have this parameterized reward as some kind of negative distance between next state and then some goal state, and let's assume like gamma equals zero for now, the discount factor, then if you learn a Q function for that, that Q function is basically exactly the same as this kind of C. So what it shows that Q function captures something, basically kind of information about the model of the dynamics, and you can use Q function to do model-based planning. And the nice thing about this is that when you learn Q function, that's the algorithm you use is model-free. So often you have, you're not kind of limited by some kind of problems you encounter in model-based training. So now there's kind of connection to the classic model-based, but then this is still not useful because it's like a single step, so, and perhaps it's constraint optimization. But so just like this, it has no limited applicability. So the idea is, can we learn new kind of like, basically now when we talk about kind of model, the only model we know is just single step model. And the idea is, can we use TD learning to learn new kind of family of models that describe the NDP? And that's where we introduced temporal difference models. So how can you generalize models on NDP? So it's a simple trick. You basically add a kind of this kind of planning horizon, so tau. Basically, you only get the reward at the end of the planning horizon. And basically, you can write down kind of standard of policy Q learning objective like this, where each time step the tau decrements, and you get the reward only at the end. But the nice thing about this is that, so this learns some kind of multi-step model of dynamics in that what this Q function means after learning of policy is basically after, if your goal was to reach SG in, say, tau time steps, what is the state you, what is the distance between the state you end up and then the goal SG, if you can learn this Q function perfectly. Then what you can do is you can use this to do multi-step version of MPC. So in standard MPC single step, you plan every kind of single step. But now with this, you can basically just substitute different kind of tau and then plan, say, every kind of case step or so. In extreme case, you just kind of plan for kind of single step in that you directly kind of plug in the whole kind of planning horizon. And all you do is basically you just optimize for the for basically the kind of goal you try to reach in order to kind of maximize the reward at the end. So I may have rushed this a bit, but intuitively, some of the details also in the paper, but the kind of idea is basically now you just need to plan every kind of k time step. So what you're effectively doing is some kind of instance of hardcore reinforcement learning. Basically, you're using this kind of this Q function that can, say, reach any kind of step or in like given if the tau time step as a kind of sub policy, and the hardware policy is basically finding what goal should you kind of plan every kind of case step to get the maximum reward of the task. So there's some kind of limitation. One limitation is that it ignores intermediate rewards if you prime every so often. But then often for reinforcement learning, you actually just care about the reward at the end. So for the task we tried, actually this was not a problem. Bigger problem is probably because you need to solve this kind of constraint optimization if you just have a Q function. And if the Q function is a neural network, that's quite unstable and difficult. So this is kind of, I'll rush to some detail. The kind of nice thing about kind of policy Q learning stuff is that it's actually very straightforward to vectorize it. So if the reward function, say like a distance measure can be vectorized over the kind of dimensions, then you can also kind of vectorize the kind of Q function. So maybe, let's see. So one of the things is that you actually know the kind of Q function basically represents some kind of distance between the some kind of goal state and the future state you reach. So you can just kind of include that as kind of build block of the Q function. And if you do that, basically you can learn something that resembles like a model. There's kind of more details to it that I can cut for the time's sake. But basically with this, what you can do is you can do explicit MPC. So you can just use directly, you can directly use this kind of F, which is sort of like Go condition, kind of multi-step predictive model of dynamics, to predict kind of what state you end up directly, instead of like framing in this kind of constraint optimization form. There's kind of more subtle differences, but for interest, please ask me later. So for the results, I'll describe the basic things. We run on kind of benchmark domains called continuous control. And then say the orange one is the DDPG. So they all kind of converge very kind of nicely to kind of best performance, but often is much slower than say model based, which is the purple one, or the TDM. The model based converge like very fast and also accurately for simple domain like Reacher. But for something as difficult like say Ant, where the locomotion dynamics is more tricky, this kind of gap, it basically incurs the gap. It converges very fast, but then there's kind of bias in the asymptotic performance of the final policy. So overall, basically TDM can significantly increase sample efficiency in kind of all those kind of cases tested, and basically converge to the kind of same kind of final performance as kind of as model-free methods. So in discussion, I think hopefully I kind of mentioned gives me kind of confidence that increasing this kind of cherry for kind of model-free reinforcement learning can sometimes be as good or even better than model-based approach. And I think the important question to ask in reinforcement learning is how can we reframe model-free RL such that you can get much more signals? Because only then, probably the deep learning aspect of it make a lot of sense. And also the RL just is very exciting problems, but also many problems and future potentials. And thank you for listening to the talk.
So we have time for questions.
How do you do the constraint optimization of the model actions with the unstable?
So I avoid, I avoid the constraint optimization, by framing in this way. Yeah, so here, this is the final form I use. And this F is basically just a part of the Q function. They parameterize. Yeah, and you can kind of see this as, this is basically predicting from the state and action, if your goal was say to S T plus T, in if you want to reach there in T minus one, what's the state you actually reach? If you can learn perfectly, yeah. Yes.
So the intuition with the model kind of depends on your choice of the reward as a distance metric, right?
Yes, exactly, yeah. So for the experiments we tried kind of L1 system, but because you can vectorize it easily, and yeah, but it definitely depends a lot on that. So if, for example, the state is like images, then probably you need to learn some kind of metrics rather than just using the standard loss.
All right, then let's thank Shane again for a great talk.